So we've just been talking about acute mountain sickness that you get for a few days when you go up to altitude. But other people get chronic mountain sickness after a while. And sometimes even after they've been adapted, it doesn't work anymore.
Right.
You know, what is chronic mountain sickness?
Yeah, chronic mountain sickness was first identified by a Peruvian physician, Carlos Monge, actually Carlos Monge Sr., in the 1930s. And he observed that people in the Andes in Peru at high altitudes, a certain percentage of people who had been living healthy lives, they were adults and they had families and so forth, lost their adaptation. Hmm. They got sick in a very characteristic way. One was they became extremely hypoxemic. And
what
by that
mean?
I mean that the level of oxygen in their blood plunged.
Really?
Yeah, it's already low because
they're
at altitude.
So they've lived there for like many years?
And exactly. They could be 30, 40, 20.
Seems very odd.
It's very odd. And so it was as if, oh my gosh, what's going on? And if you see pictures of these people, they've got blue lips from being deoxygenated, blue earlobes, fingers. And their hemoglobin concentration goes higher than it was before.
Higher.
So blood gets even thicker. And they don't sleep well, and they can't work. And there's a very simple cure for it, and that is to leave altitude.
Sounds hard if that's where you've been living for a decade.
That's the point. If you've been living there your whole life, this is where your family is, this is where your farm is, this is where your land is. And so most people don't.
Is there anything to be done?
Bloodletting, regular bloodletting is effective. Yeah.
So I'm going to, I mean, this is the typical naive guess, but if a person's up at altitude for that long, at some point the mechanism for making more hemoglobin kicks in more than it should.
Yes.
Is that sufficient to cause the symptoms, do you think?
We don't know. Uh-huh. I mean, we do know that age is one thing. Okay. Being older increases your risk. Having higher hemoglobin increases your risk. But exactly what happens, the process, we have one interesting hint. And this comes from some studies in the Andes of young adult men who already have chronic mountain sickness. They're in their 20s. Mm-hmm. And it's unusual, but it does happen that they develop chronic mountain sickness. And an interesting study asked their mothers about their pregnancies with these kids. Mm-hmm. And young men whose mothers had complications during pregnancies, or if the child itself needed oxygen after birth, that increased the risk of chronic mountain sickness. So it's as if there might be a perinatal period there where additional stress that appears to be transient, and whatever it is that enabled these individuals to survive that, increases their vulnerability to chronic mountain sickness as adults. Mm.
But we don't really know why it happens to some people and others.
Nope.
And we also don't know why acute mountain sickness happens more to people than others.
No.
These are great questions
they
for somebody
are.
Watching this video to make a whole career out of and help a lot of people.
That's right. A lot of people would be very happy to prevent those.
And it might well be possible to understand these things and figure them out.
Yeah, I think so.
Great.